Hi, Bonnie. How are you going?
Good.
We heard that you were in Australia for a little bit, so we thought we'd catch up some time with you and have a chat to you about your adventures in roller derby. So you started with Los Angeles, but then you went on to do some pretty amazing things on your own after that. How long were you involved in roller derby?
I started in October of 2003, and then I retired the second time in September 2013.
So where did you go from Los Angeles? Where did your journey take you from there?
Well, I'd been commuting from Oceanside, which is the north part of San Diego, to Los Angeles to skate, and I couldn't do it anymore. And I was suggesting to the LA founders, like, it'd be cool if you guys started a league in San Diego, because at the time, I think there was only 10 leagues in existence when I brought this up. And they were like, yeah, you should do that. I was like, no, you should do that. I don't know how to do anything. I'm 24. Yeah. I don't know how to do stuff. And I'd never been in charge of anything. But basically, it would just came down to if I wanted to continue skating, I was going to need to build my own playground, because it just wasn't practical to keep driving to Los Angeles all the time. And they were really supportive, and they taught me, you know, what their structure was. And San Diego Derby Dolls was created as the sister league of the LA Derby Dolls. And next thing you knew, I was in a very big position that I was completely unqualified for, just as many of us find ourselves in derby.
Yeah. And, well, I guess that's one of the things, about our sport that's quite unique is we're building it from the ground up, and we're really a part of that. That start, and you certainly have been one of the pioneers of all of that. And when you say you were building yourself a playground, you built one of the biggest playgrounds, I think, in California, maybe even in the world. And how long has it been around now, San Diego Derby Dolls?
We started in June of 2005. And the woman that runs it now, Isabel Ringer, she's like honed and perfected every single one of the dreams that we had, because she was there when we sat down and wrote these goals as a league, in a party room of a skating rink, talking about just how beautiful we wanted our warehouse to be and how we wanted it to look. And we wanted a flat track beside a bank track, and we wanted lockers and couches. And I'd say I got us about 65% there. And when I say I got us there, it's like, it was like me and three, four generations of skaters, on the turnover in 6 years. 7 years, it was me and all these other people, like, sort of building that bridge, and she took the next few and built it the rest of the way, and it's a gorgeous, amazing monster of a place now.
Yeah, it sounds like it.
Yeah.
Goal setting is definitely something that I want to talk to you about, I guess, as an individual, but also on a broader perspective as the league.
Yeah.
But in terms of your league, and I mean, most businesses fail in the first 2 years. So for a not-for-profit, volunteer-run organization to be running for what you're going into your 12th year now, that's pretty impressive. So do you have some tips around sustainability as a league that you learned along the way?
Wow, it sounds really cool when you put it like that.
It's amazing. It is amazing.
Well, let me just take in what you just said, because that is pretty cool. Yeah, I think, honestly, strong leadership is really important. And I may not have been qualified to be a leader when it happened, but I was absolutely determined to do it well. And so I studied the art of leadership in as many different ways as I could. I went to seminars, I read books. You know, I did everything that I possibly could to learn leadership, and never stopped. I never assumed that I knew it all. I never assumed that I understood it all. And I always felt like there was room for improvement on that. And the woman that took over for me is a natural leader who also studies the art, studies the craft of leadership. And you're not the first person to be in charge of something, and the people who have been in charge of things before have left a trail. And I think it's really important to take whatever your position is in the league seriously and study the art of it. Because the better that you can be at that, the more you can understand how to pull together a team and know how to take in different perspectives and dream together. I mean, my vision as the founder was really strong, but I understood that I was just one person and I had to take the dreams of everyone into consideration. So I think a huge part of sustainability is being able to study the art and include everyone else's dreams as well. But there does come a certain point where the ink is on the paper and you say, these are the goals and these are the tenets and this is what we're going to stand for. And at that point, you sort of need to, you know, commit to that and make it grow and let everyone that comes in know this is, as you come in, this is what you're joining. This is what you're a part of. We're not the only game in town. If it doesn't feel like a good fit for you, that's okay. There's other options and we support your decision. But this is the thing that we're building. And to be consistent like that with what the dream is, what the goals are and the vision is really important.
That's a good point. I think consistency is very important for some people, and having inconsistency can be very stressful for people as well.
And I wasn't always successful at consistency, absolutely not by any stretch of the imagination, but I was single-minded in what the goals were. I wasn't necessarily consistent on the execution. No one's perfect. It's definitely not me.